Okay. So essentially in this game, you guys are a small team who are piloting a vessel very similar to the Nostromo. Right? Nostromo. It was a little bit newer, a little bit more advanced, you know, a little bit more decked out. You're not technically licensed as a cargo hauler. The Nostromo was carrying stuff. You guys actually are carrying things internally, and you guys are in the process of doing like a 2-year trip back from one of the frontier countries, frontier planets, and you're carrying massive amounts of helium-3. It's a very powerful volatile substance. But for a small crew like you guys should be able to get a fair amount of money for it. Questions or so far?
Nope, good to go.
All right, how is everyone ready to go?
I think so.
Good for me.
Well, welcome to the game. So, what is the story so far? Well, you guys are all space truckers, and you are on the star freighter, the USCSS Montero, running the gauntlet, it's called, on the trade route between Anchor Point Station and the Frontier. Your ship's cargo hold is packed with dozens of tanks of the rare gas helium-3. Cargoes such as these are towed in a massive tanker, but you guys are not. You guys are not classified as a hauler, so you actually got everything internally. The Montero isn't rated as a commercial towing vehicle, however, and this small run is a special order for Waylon and Yutani. Okay, so you're kind of doing this as a personal favor, or you know, a quick run for the company, and. Quick, easy money. So you guys are en route to Sutter's World, a newly established frontier colony. While the trip so far has been fairly routine, Montero sensors developed a glitch before you left Anchor Point and sporadically pinged contact with the sensor reflection before you activated the displacement drive and went faster than light. So just before you guys took off, your sensor started one of your vessels started to pick up these false readings. All right, it was pinging often, and then you guys never had a chance to fix it. Went in the faster than light. Your cargo run so far has been without incident. Now you are just awakening from hypersleep, ready to deliver your goods to the colony of Sutter's World. So I will bring up the map. So to help get everybody into the feel of this, I'm going to ask each of you to, in your own words, put a little bit of flavor into your characters. Describe. We'll start off with Dan. Or sorry, Davis.
Oh, I'm sorry. I had my cough. So, my name's Davis. I'm the pilot of this thing. I signed up for the action. And that is the one thing that a cargo run does not have, and it is driving me fucking insane. So, the sooner we can get this over with, and the sooner we can get going, the better off I'm going to feel about the whole thing.
All right, and how about Mr. Wilson? Or Miller, sorry? Wilson, sorry, I keep calling him Miller.
Yeah, Wilson? Okay. My name's John Wilson. I am the corporate liaison for Wayland Corporation, and I've been with you guys for about 6 months now. Right side by side, making sure that the runs are going smoothly, and we're following the company orders, and seem to get along with just about everybody in the crew, with only one or two minor exceptions.
Sounds cool. Thank you. And how about Rye?
I'm Rye. I'm your roughneck for this voyage. Everyone just calls me Rye, including my friends, which there's really not many on here anyway, so it doesn't... I signed up because there wasn't much... I didn't have many skills, so there wasn't much available for me. I'm just trying to earn a couple coins. Not really looking for excitement, I can tell you that much.
All right. And we have some of the other people that are working with you guys on this ship is a Cham. He's also a roughneck. He's kind of a loner. His parents sold, loaders and equipment in the frontiers, and he went from colony to colony. He never really stayed in any place long. Kind of a drifter type of thing. Anyway, he's just like the typical cargo handler of the group. But he's loyal. He's loyal to the crew. He's loyal to the company, and he just wants to do a good job and be recognized for it. And the last member of the crew is the actual captain, which is Officer Miller. And tired of being the corporate clog, and you just want to get out. This finally, she's almost ready to retire. This could be the trip that does it, the last trip. So that's it. That's really her. So I want you guys to imagine you're just coming out of these cryo stasis pods. You've probably been in them now for this stint, probably 6 months, 7 months, and you guys are all terribly dehydrated. On your character sheets, there is a box to tick if you are dehydrated.
Roger.
Now, everyone's a little bit nauseous. You're just coming out. The computers are beeping, and things are just starting to. You're just trying to get your feet together. Get yourself put together and get ready to manage the day. Usually in these operations, you usually wake up anywhere between 6 hours to 24 hours before you actually get to your final destination.
They ain't paying us enough for this, man.
Captain Miller, the officer, she kind of gets up and she's like, "All right, ladies, let's get yourselves dressed. Let's all meet in the mess hall in about 15 minutes, and we'll figure out what we got to do next." Everyone clear on that?
Aye, aye.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
I don't say anything. I just take one of my pills.
So, after several minutes, some time of getting yourselves dressed, putting your clothes on, you know, the floor seems feels very cold. You know, everything's been in low stasis for the last little while. The life supports are on minimum, so trying to get the heat, everything else cold to the feet. You guys find yourselves all in the galley. So everyone moved their character sheets. Oh, and I should get the other characters as well. So let me get them. I can't believe no one took the captain.
Captain, you're my buddy, but we're not that type buddy.
All right, so you're all sitting in the galley. You're all having your drinks and stuff. Do you guys want to sit down and start having some food and try to get rid of your dehydration? Or do you want to go right to the bridge and or start doing your things? What would you like to do?
I want to eat.
All right, so that is Rye.
Yeah, sorry, Rye wants to eat, definitely.
Yeah, I want to get hydrated if I can.
Wilson's probably going to go up to the bridge just to make sure that we're on schedule.
Okay, no problem. So you'll head on up. And Miller is actually going to move up to the bridge as well. Okay, so you guys, Rye and Davis, you guys can check off your dehydration markers right now. You had a little bit of food, a little bit of drink, and you're feeling pretty good. All right. Suddenly, as you guys are up on the bridge, there, Wilson, you notice that you start hearing some your sensors. You can obviously tell that the sensors are starting to pick something up.
Yeah, I'll check out the sensors. Just see what's going on.
You're certainly getting a signal saying that there is some sort of ship approaching, and do you have comm tech on your skill? What's your skill on comm tech?
I do. It is comm tech 1, I believe.
All right. So the way it works is your comm tech is added to your associated attribute. So where is it?
In this case, wits.
Yes. So it's going to be wits.
So that's how many dice I roll?
Correct. Your wits plus your comm tech.
Okay. I only rolled 3, but I got a success.
Well, it shows to you that it's definitely that false reading again, 100%.
Over my shoulder, I'll kind of yell back at Miller and say, "Hey, Captain, we still getting that signal that we were getting before we jumped out." Seems to be the same bug in the system that we had before, but you might want to check this out.
Yeah, we'll. I'll get Davis to come up and have a look at that. He was supposed to have a look at that before we took off, but I guess never had time, as always with this guy. always in a rush to do something, but never really gets anything done. we'll, hey, Davis, you copy?
I copy.
Listen, when you get a chance, when you're done eating your dinner there and you get your slippers and everything put on, can you come up to the bridge and start looking at those sensors, please?
Oh, it'd be my pleasure.
All right, so sensor was going off. Wilson has determined that it was a false reading. Anyone else like to do anything, or?
Now, Rye's just going to take it easy for now.
Okay. Wilson, while you were up there, you also see Miller looking at the comm panels, and you see that there's a notification there for her. And these types of notifications usually means that Mother, the mainframe computer, has something for her or needs to tell her something. And it's blinking there. And, you know, you see Miller.
I'm going to try to, like, take a look at it over. The message isn't on the... It isn't on the screen right now. You have to go to the mainframe to get it?
That's correct, yeah. But it's just letting her know that there's a special message there.
Okay.
So she disappears into there.
While she's doing that, I'm going to head to the galley and try to get some chow. Now that I know that we're everything seems to be nominal.
Okay. All right. So you can go back and get yourself straightened away.
Hey, Wilson, what's going on up there?
Ah, it's that... those fracking sensors. Davis is on it, but I still got that same bug that we had when we jumped out.
You want me to take a look at it with Wilson?
Oh, I'm sorry. You're Davis, aren't you? No, you're Ryan.
Oh,
Ryan. I'm Wilson. So I was just, no, I'm sure. I'm just gonna grab some quick chow here, real quick, and we'll let Davis get a hand on it.
All right. And I'll just put my feet up and sit back and keep eating.
So, I have an observation skill.
Okay.
And I don't know if it's applicable to looking at these comm boards and trying to figure out what this glitch is.
No, that would not be... It would be a comm tech skill is what you would need. So, after a few moments, Miller comes back out onto the bridge, and she's like, Davis, change of plans.
Yeah.
It seems like we got new orders from the company. Seems like there was a distress call from this vessel that was lost, and apparently they just picked it up. I guess while we were in flight here, and it seems that they've ordered us to go and investigate this distress call.
I don't like that. I signed up to just make a delivery, not to operate a salvage mission.
Well, it looks like we're going to have to try to discover this. We're going to have to try and triangulate where this distress call is coming from, because we're going to have to check it out. Now, you can radio ahead if you want and tell Sutter's station that we're going to... we're going to be a little while longer, a little bit delayed, if you want, but we're going to have to check it out.
All right, so is that an order to radio ahead?
Well, do I have to make it an order, Davis, or... Or are you just being
difficult? you might want to order me to do that. I really don't like this, but okay. I guess you're the captain.
I don't know what's gotten into you, Davis, but I'm telling you.
All right, so I'll radio ahead.
But let me tell you this one thing. If we don't do this, we just forfeit all of our fees and our money for the hall. So I'm pretty sure you're going to want to do this.
Yeah.
Looks like we don't have a choice unless we want to go broke.
Doing it and wanting to do it are two different things, Captain.
Ain't that the truth? So, Miller, the captain, she announces over to PA and says that it looks like there's a slight change of plans. We're going to try and track down this, we just received a distress call, and we're going to try and track it down.
And hearing that, Wilson says, God damn it. It's going to make us miss our drop-off point.
All right, Wilson, you can check off your dehydration now if you want.
Okay.
So, Miller, you want me to alter the course here so we can start our triangulation on this signal?
Yeah, please, if you don't mind, you go ahead and just do what you got to do, and we'll start tracking this down.
All right, I'm going to start taking long legs with the ship so that we can kind of triangulate where the signal's coming from.
Wilson walks his way up to the bridge and just kind of enters the bridge, but just starts observing.
So you can see Davis up there. He's trying to make some moves there and get the ship turned around and, you know, do some maneuvering, and then suddenly. You're hearing these alarms go off in the background, and it's your collision alarms. Apparently something is within very close range of the ship. And just as Davis is starting to turn the ship, you can see directly in front of you a large ship coming directly towards you.
Jesus.
Davis, you need to make a piloting roll at a -2 to avoid a collision with a ship that you didn't, but no one seemed to have noticed.
All right, so I've got a piloting skill of 3. Does that mean I've got 3 dice to roll?
3 plus whatever your skill is associated with it. So I think it's agility.
Okay. That I don't know.
Yeah, so it's agility plus your piloting.
Oh, okay. I got an agility of 5.
Nice. That's why you're the pilot.
Ah, very good. So that's 8?
Yep.
All together?
So -2. So 6.
All right. And so my other question is about the push feature.
Yep.
So if this should fail... I could push it, and that puts me at risk of stress. Is that
correct?
Correct.
Yep. Okay. So let me get some dice rollers to it. Oh no, you don't need to do that, Dan. Hold on, I'll show you.
Oh, very good.
I got dice rollers made. Oh. What's going on there?
Oh, very nice. So I got stress dice. I got Very good.
So we'll put those back on your table there.
Very fancy.
So all you gotta do is click on it the total amount of times, just your base dice. So you failed your roll. If you want to try again, you can add a stress. So you would add a stress to your character sheet, and then you would roll all the dice that you want to roll again, and you also then roll a stress dice.
Davis, what the fuck are you doing? Invade that thing.
I'll go ahead and push it.
All right, so give yourself a stress on your character sheet. So you keep track of stress. So up here.
And then you roll one stress die with your...
Yeah.
So does that replace a dice, or does it...
No, it actually adds to it.
Additive.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I roll my 6 dice again plus a stress dice.
So you only need one success, and you got yourself 3. So with skills, you can actually do extra things. So we're looking at your piloting. For every extra success that you've rolled, you get to do what's called stunts.
You can,
for every dice that you rolled, you can say you plus 1 to a modification to a later skill roll relating to this one. So if you want the bank plus 1, you can.
What those counters are for.
Yes.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I gotcha. I see. So I could have a plus 1. Now, would that is that for any roll, or is that for a piloting
roll? For piloting roll.
Okay. Very good. What else can you do with that?
In this particular thing, you can do a plus 1 modification to a later skill roll, or you can show off. It just makes it look fancy.
I was going to show off, and my idea is to take the momentum from my collision avoidance and sidle right up next to that ship into a docking position.
Well, you've avoided it, first of all. If you want to get close to it, it's going to be another piloting roll, minus 2.
All right. I will use. Can I use my plus 1 on that?
You can, yep.
All right. Well, then I will get close to it. So that would be a roll of 5. Is that
5.
Correct?
And don't forget, you always got to roll the number of stress dice that you have.
Oh, okay.
Stress is constant, right? So the more you use stress, the more stress builds up.
Yeah, I see. 1, 2.
Wait, I thought your piloting was 8 total to start.
But it's minus 2.
Oh, yeah, but it's minus 2.
So that's 6.
There you go. So you are successful, and you managed to bring the ship directly alongside. Now, everyone inside the gravity simulators were kind of hard pressed. Everyone kind of falls over, and the stuff comes spilling from the shelves. Poor
Rye. I can't tell you how much that pleases me either.
Poor Rye down in the galley. You know, he got completely. You know, he spilled his drinks, his cereals, all messed up all over him, all that stuff. Right. So it's
this would be typical of my piloting.
But you find yourself directly alongside this, what looks to be almost like a military craft, but it's all the lights are off. There's no lights, and it's just kind of drifting casually past, and you guys kind of just almost crash right into it.
So we need to figure out if this is the if this is our distress ship or if it's just some jerk.
Yeah. What do you want to do?
I don't
well,
know.
Well, Miller, the captain, says, yeah. Well, he looks at Wilson. You're the company man here. What do you want to do?
Well, that's not one of our ships. It looks colonial. Is this in our mandate? I'm not really sure what the protocol is here.
Well, all of a sudden you get another blinking message, and this time it is for you, Wilson, to head into talk to
Mother. All right, I will go into the mainframe and access the message.
While you're doing that, Rai shows up into the bridge and says, "Good flying there. Spilled my shreddies all over me." And you can see this, like, wet. Rai's shirt is all wet. Like, what the hell happened?
My pleasure, Rai. Gotta keep them guessing.
All right, so let me see here. So I am going to put a into your notebook, Wilson.
Yep.
And I'll let you deal with that how you want to. But you can see that it is a colonial ship called the USCSS Kronos. And by the flying of Davis, they actually put you right alongside with it, so you're able to determine who it is right off the get-go.
I'm getting antsy up here. We need to figure out what we're going to do.
We get paid extra when we board another ship, right?
Miller looks at it. You're going to get paid whatever the company wants to pay. But yes, I'm sure there's a bonus for something like this.
I want my hazardous duty pay.
As long as we get our salvage rights.
Okay, while I'm in here, I'm going to use my keycard access to try to access the prior message that that Miller got.
Oh, okay. No problem at all. So, the message that Miller got earlier is pretty much saying that the ship has been rerouted to track down the source of a distress call, which is the Kronos. And essentially saying that if you do not investigate the source of this, all your pay is going to be forfeited. You're not going to get anything for the cargo run if you go against company orders.
Okay. So I'll come out of the comm shed there and I'll say I say to the assembled crew there, well, it looks like we need to check this out. This seems to be this is possibly the source of the distress call that we were told to go investigate. And I think it's also important that we make sure that we see if there's any survivors and escort this ship back to Anchorage to make sure that it can get repaired at a Wayland facility.
Oh my gosh, Compty man, that is going to take forever. I did not sign up to spend forever in space. I got to get my medicine.
Well, as far as
I don't have time, I'm going to run out of medicine out here hauling this damn ship around. It'd be better off if we never saw the thing.
Well, I can promise you there's going to be bonuses all around if we get this accomplished.
Whoa. Yeah, how much are the bonuses?
Oh, well, I'm sure it's going to be at least, double time or double pay, so I wouldn't worry too much about that.
Yeah, it better be that high.
So,
and I look at Miller and I'm like, well, you know, and Captain, isn't it customary to aid vessels in distress, regardless of the situation?
Yeah, you're right, Wilson. Guys, this is what we got to do. If something ever happened to us, well, I would expect the same thing. So we're gonna do what the company has asked us to do. We'll go check it out. Davis, you did a good job getting us fairly close to the ship here. You're with that really good flying. So I take back my little snotty comments earlier.
I kind of bump Davis on the shoulder and say, yeah, I'll make sure I put that in my report for you.
I don't like it. I don't like it.
So the ship comes equipped with a extendable umbilical for hooking up to airlocks. It also everyone also has spacesuits that they can suit up in. Miller's trying to figure out the best thing to do, and she looks at Wilson and says, well, what should we do? Should we try to hook up a umbilical or a spacewalk? Send someone over for a spacewalk.
Well, I would go with the umbilical. I think that'll make things a little easier, a little quicker.
Yeah, I think umbilical.
We still have to deliver this load of H3, so anything we can do to expedite this would be great.
Oh, I'm right there with you. I got to get my medicine.
Okay. So, I am now going to... Oh, there was a two background. So, if everyone presses the letter P on their keyboard and changes it to first person, you'll be able to look around a little bit better at the background image.
Oh, wow.
So this is the Kronos that you see drifting before you. And the mainframe, Mother, some stuff starts to come up on the screen, and she actually... Oh. is that not working right? She actually prints up the schematics of the chromes. Sorry, wrong button.
That's a big ship.
All right, Rye, it's time for you to earn your keep, Miller says. Get down and extend that umbilical, but I'm telling you, don't wreck it, okay? It's the only one we got. If you punch a hole in it, we'll have to go over in spacesuits.
Yeah, that shouldn't be a problem. I mean, I've only been doing this job for years.
All right, so... if you want to activate the umbilical, it's going to be a heavy machinery roll. And you just got to hook it up.
All right.
And you got yourself a extra... You got yourself an extra success. So I'm just going to look at your skills here, see what you can do. No, so you can save yourself a plus one for later.
That sounds like a great idea.
Or you can save it so you don't need to... If you need to operate this again, you don't need to make a roll. You can automatically succeed if you want to operate the umbilical again.
I think I'm gonna take the plus one.
Okay. So you got two successes, was it? I can't remember.
Yeah, two successes.
All right, yeah, so you can save a plus one for later. For heavy machinery.
I'm sure we won't have to retract this arm or anything in any sort of... I won't need to make an automatic success for later. That'll never happen.
You just jinxed the whole entire... adventure. I can see it now. All right, so based on Davis's flying and Roy's ability to operate the umbilical, you guys hook up quite well. So, the umbilical... Let me see here. You guys, the umbilical connects to the section called Junction A1, and that is on A deck.
Roger, gotcha.
So I'll draw a little circle there for everyone. And that's where you guys are connected. The question is, who wants to go across?
I'll go across. Wilson.
Is there life support on there?
You can't tell there yet.
I guess I better go too, just in case. Don't want the company thinking I didn't put enough work in to get my extra bonus.
So does the I'm going to have to surmise that there's probably autopilot available for our ship, the Montero. Is that correct?
There is autopilot. You can put it into a steady orbit around it if you wanted to.
All right, and because I would reckon if this is a salvage mission, which is good because there might be some action, that there'll probably be a call for a pilot on this derelict ship.
All right, so I guess the three of you guys are going across. The captain, Miller, is going to stay on board, and the other, Roughneck. So I'm going to move these guys just off the table for a second. Put them right there. And I'm going to take this and move this off the table. And I'm going to bring up Deck A.
What kind of suits are we going to be putting on to enter?
They do have suits on board. They are the Mark 50 compression suits. All right. And let's see, Mark 50 compression suits. So on the, they have an armor rating of 2. They have an air supply of 5. They have a weight of 1. So essentially, you can carry up to twice the number of items as your brawn, as your strength. And your agility is -1 while you're in the suits. So on the back of the tables there, you'll see like the charts with all the information on it. There's a section there called Suits and Armor.
Yep, got it.
So that's where the information is for that. Now you do have, I will, in your notebooks, I will put it up so everyone can see it. Is a section there called gray or gear, sorry, and it shows you all the available gear and equipment that you guys can carry. So before you actually go across, you guys can choose what you guys want to take. So everyone see that gear section?
Oh, yeah.
So Miller pretty much says, yeah, guys, take what you think you need, and everything will be all right.
So, do we need to divide this up, or is there enough for everyone?
There's enough suits for everybody.
Oh, okay, because there's five, right?
There's five. Five.
Gotcha.
Is there any life signs on? Did we scan the ship?
You can't tell if there's any life signs on the ship. You can tell that everything seems to be in minimal power mode. So there could be, everything could be in like basic life support in there right about now. Maybe. It's hard to tell.
Then we might have to do some work. I might need the cutting torch then.
Yeah, I'm going to take a service pistol. As a pilot, I was trying to kill myself in case I was ever captured.
Where were the... where was the...
Under notebook, under gear at the bottom.
Oh, cheers. Thank you. Oh, okay, so there's only one motion tracker, there's only one cutting torch, got it.
Yeah, that's right. So I'm quite impressed that the pilot actually managed to avoid the collision and also put himself into a immediate orbit and synchronizing orbit with the ship. That was really good.
Yeah, that's what I do.
So if anybody doesn't mind, I'll go ahead and I'll take the motion tracker.
That's no problem.
Yeah.
Should not by me anyway.
Nope, go for it.
Is somebody going to bring the cutting torch? Is that going to be you, Davis?
Nope, Rye's got the cutting torch.
That's perfect. And then we've got basically three... weapon type things. Service pistol, the harpoon grappling gun, and the...
Yeah, I grabbed the service pistol.
Alright, no worries. Rye, do you want to take the harpoon gun, and I'll take the bolt gun? Just...
Sure.
I think we're good.
So there's still a incinerator unit.
A flamethrower?
In case we have to sterilize something.
Well, we've got another crew member we can bring along as well.
Oh, yeah. And what about the power loader? I guess if we need to transfer something, we can come back for that.
I don't think we're going to need that right off the bat. I think the priority, gentlemen, should be we get the power back onto the ship. Then we should be able to access any of the computer files, and also we'll need to do a sweep to see if there's any survivors that we can assess.
That's right. Get in, separate the living from the dead, find any useful objects, and return what we can. Save who we can. I'm with you.
Now, is my computer dying, or did it get darker?
Oh, no, it got darker.
Okay, that's, as long as I didn't do something, that's cool.
I'm just playing around with the lights. To give that sense of darkness that's in there.
I like it.
All right, so you guys feel that you're all kitted up enough?
Yeah, is it just the three of us, or are we bringing the fourth crew member? I can't remember his name.
Well, Cham was going to stay behind, but do you want him to come along?
Well, this is a pretty large ship. Captain Miller, you got any... objection to having Chan join us? At least that way we can, if we have to split up, we can have two-man teams.
Yeah, no, that's a good idea. You, Chan, you go on ahead.
Yeah, you take the point.
The red shirt. Chan, make sure you pick up one of those flamer units before, you know, after you get strapped into your suit and before you cross the umbilical.
Chan gets a flamer unit. Okay, so for everyone who has suits, they have 5 resources. So that's air. And so everyone make sure you keep track of that, because you could run out of air. Bad things can happen that you can run out of air and you may have to take your suit off. So the way resources work is that the higher the number, when something happens, say we're using the suits, if you do something stressful, you have to roll 5 stress dice. And if you get any of the stress icons, you'll lose a number of air units based on that what you get. All right. So if you roll 3 stress icons, you lose 3 air units.
That is hard.
All right. So, but as the lower you go, the less dice you roll. So the less chances you'll end up rolling the 1. You know what I mean? So we are going to be entering what's called stealth mode. And the way stealth mode works is that everyone's going to do a turn. And when they do their turn, that's anywhere between 5 and 10 minutes that's used up. That's changed. Okay? You can move 2 zones and no problem. If you want to explore a zone, you got to spend the full turn in that zone getting information.
So are those gray dotted lines kind of defining zones?
Those gray dotted lines are actually access air ducts that go throughout the ship. And then any of those little dots actually is a way that goes up or down to and connects to other levels.
Gotcha.
All All right. So is everyone kitted up? They feel happy with the...
Oh, yeah, Rye's good.
All right, so the four of you all, start walking down the umbilical, and it doesn't, you don't have to get very far, and you can see that the airlock that the umbilical is connected to in the Kronos is damaged, and it is buckled.
Hmm.
So I guess I didn't do a good job putting it out.
Hey guys, and it looks like that might have been from before.
I'll take a look and see if it's something I did or if it's existing damage to the other ship or what.
Yeah. Sorry about that. All right. So so it appears that the airlock has been damaged, but it doesn't look like it's been damaged from the outside. It looks like it was damaged from the inside. It's buckled outwards.
Good. We're going to need that information for insurance purposes.
get your phone out. Take a picture.
So you're going to either have to cut your way in or find another way in.
Can I do a visual inspection and see if does it look like any air is venting out anywhere? Like, is there a breach? Have they lost a good seal on the door?
That is a very good question.
I'm picturing this umbilical as a type of tube that connects in between the two ships.
Yes, that's correct.
And I'm concerned that if the inside of this ship has been pressurized enough to buckle the airlock outward, that there might be pressure behind that door. And it might be possible that if we were successful in opening that hatch, that it could damage the umbilical as well.
Well, based on what Wilson is seeing there, the door seems to have the green lock saying that everything is pressurized behind, so everything is equalized.
It's not leaking any air, no. So that means it is pressurized.
Yep.
Which means that, you're right. That's a good fear. If we try to cut this thing, then all that pressure is going to get sucked out.
So, but everything is kind of pressurized. The umbilical that you're in right now is pressurized. And
it is pressurized.
Yes.
Okay. So if as long as that pressure inside is normal, then it should be equalized. All right.
Yeah, go ahead and cut it. Yeah, cut it.
All right, I'll get up there, get the torch going, and get to.
All right, it is a heavy machinery roll. And that is your strength plus your heavy machinery.
Look at that.
Nice.
Oh, and he gets it. Well done. So it doesn't take very long, and he actually cuts it fairly well. And you hear this little bit of a popping noise, and some air kind of hisses. Isolated, but it still, or sorry, everything was equalized, but there's still a little bit of a pressure difference, right?
But nothing violent.
Everything is kind of good.
There you go. One door open.
I'm assuming our suits have some kind of a lighting
capability?
Yes, they do. Yep.
Like a headlamp, so I'll go ahead and flip my headlamp on just in case, and shall we, gentlemen? And I'll go ahead and cross the threshold.
All right. So as you walk in, you find yourself in the airlock room, and it's everything seems normal, but all the lights are off. Everything is dark, and only seems to have basic lighting, like emergency lighting. A little bit of lights around the floor, a little bit of lights around the the door frames. You can't see very far.
Okay. From the earlier analysis of the floor plans, ship plans, where would we find, I would assume engineering is where we need to go to get the power back on?
I'll put the map at the far end down here.
There we go. Let me just take a look at that real quick.
And you can also tell that the moisture in the air, everything is kind of frozen, so there's a slight crystallization of all the moisture over all the surfaces inside as well.
But there is emergency lighting. So it makes me curious that one of the things that we should put on our to-do list is to check cryo to see if there's anybody in there or if it looks like moldy yogurt.
That's good thinking.
Okay. So what do you guys want to do?
I would, if I was to suggest something, I would suggest that we should probably check Mother out to see if there's any important logs. That should probably be the first thing we look at.
Well, I was thinking the same thing.
Oh, yeah, but we need power to do that. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, we can go verify that first just to make sure. They may... This is a military craft, so they may have some kind of a backup unit, backup power unit just for Mother, since it's critical. And something has kicked the emergency lighting on, so we may as well go ahead and check it since Mother's right here.
Yeah, sounds good.
So we'll move towards the bow of the ship and head towards Mother.
Okay. Is everyone going towards Mother?
Yeah. I am not. I'm going to stay in Junction A1 in case there's any survivors or anyone's coming forward.
Okay. And Chan will stay with you, I guess.
So are these the doors that are separating each of the modules, are they functioning?
It looks like there is power, but everything's kind of shut down, and you don't think you'll be able to get in there unless you have the right access keys anyway.
Well, I'm going to try to use my key card access to see if it'll allow me to open up the door towards Mother.
And you swipe it in, and then all of a sudden you hear like a slight hissing noise, and you start hearing some additional beeps and things, and it seems like not only does the door open for you, but it seems like the ship has... the lights start coming on again.
Interesting.
But yes, Mother is accessible.
Oh. Well, I'll go ahead and try to access Mother and pull up the ship's logs. See if there's anything in there that identifies what's going on.
Do we notice any change in lighting in Junction A1?
Yes. Junction A1, the lighting has come on. I need everyone to make a resource roll for their suits. So if you roll 5 stress dice, if you roll any ones, you subtract that many ones from your suits. For someone who's not doing anything, Davis is like sucking back the air.
That's right, I'm low on medicine, man. Worried about that medicine.
And what about you, Wilson?
Oh wait, that's not stress. That I take 2 units of air. Is that correct?
Correct. Yep.
Oops, 1 too many.
I'll just drop
ignore the last one.
So you took 1. You use up 1 bit of 1 bit of air.
All that strenuous card key accessing.
So, as the lights start to come back on, the door to the mother mainframe opens up in front of you.
All right, go on in and try to access Mother. Like I said, we'll see, I guess start with Chip's logs.
Okay, what is Rye going to do?
Rye's just going to go down, and since Rye's not allowed in with Mother, she'll go talk.
So, Rye, we were all pressurized, you know? I'm wondering what the chances are that we're in breathable atmosphere right now.
Does our suits tell us what the external atmosphere is like?
It does, yep. It picks it out. It's breathable, but it's not fresh. It's stale.
Okay. Yeah, I think I'll keep my helmet on.
So by stale, does that mean it's low in oxygen content?
You know, it's like it's got that old wet towel smell that you get if you leave your clothes in the washer for too long. Speaking
all right, I'm gonna break the suit protocol. Then I'm going to secure my suit so I can conserve some air.
You're gonna open up your suit?
I am.
Okay.
Perfect. Air scrubbers are probably running low, so we'll look at that later if we're here long enough.
Well, I'm hearing the chatter over the radio. I'd say, remember, we're supposed to salvage the ship as well, so we got to get this thing back to Anchorage. We're going to do everything we can to get it back up and running.
Well, from the looks of it, it doesn't seem like it's going to be too bad.
So, let me see here what I'm looking for. Oh, one of my sound effects are gone.
I don't know, we're hearing the SOS.
This is an older ship, that's probably a dot matrix printer.
Maybe we'll salvage that as an antique.
All right. Well, you start. Who has the motion tracker?
That would be me.
All right.
Wilson.
Wilson has the motion tracker. All right. So, so you guys are there. Did you have any questions that you wanted to ask Mother?
Status update.
Please define.
Mother, explain purpose for distress signal.
Ship was damaged, and drifting on course, cannot alter without repairs.
Damage report.
Main FTL offline. Primary life support offline. Some serious damage throughout the ship.
Recommended repairs to get ship operable.
Well, to fix the ship, let's see. They're going to have to get the main engines up online primarily.
Excellent.
Get life support stabilized.
Gotcha. Crew status.
5 crew in cryostasis. Cryostasis now activating or deactivating.
Are the crew members are they still alive?
Five of the 30 crew member alive.
Only 5. Can you play back the last ship's log? The last ship's log entry.
Log erased. All right, I'm going to get everyone now to roll again on their suits. So whatever your current number of air units are left, that's how many dice you roll. So you roll less dice.
Oh, I see.
Unless you're not wearing your suits. So Mr. Rye is doing fine. And Wilson, did you roll yet?
I did. I rolled first.
Oh, and you were successful. You never burned out any air?
Not this time.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to. I don't have to roll. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yep.
All right. So, over the comms, I'll say, all right. Mother's telling us that there are only 5 crew members in cryo. We should probably get back there and check on them. But we're going to have to get the main engines online to get life support back up and running.
But you guys want
to. And so at that, I'll head out of Mother and
That sounded kind of creepy.
Yeah. All right. So I heard. Did I hear there is 5 of 30 left of the crew members?
That's what Mother's reporting.
All right. I'm going to ready my weapon.
Cham is getting annoyed here. Guys, like, really, we're just wasting time here. What are we going to do?
Let's move aft towards the cryo units, and let's see if we can wake these people up and get some answers.
All right, so what area would you like to go to next?
I'm gonna go down the starboard side, back towards the cryo units.
Okay.
I'm right behind him.
Great. Cham is right behind you.
Nope.
And where does Rye want to go?
Do you need me to head off to the engine to get life support back on and all that?
I don't think just yet. Let's see what these folks have to say.
All right.
Miller, are you copying all this?
Yeah, I copy it loud and clear. Just do what you got to do. Let's try to be as quick as we can. So just as you round the corner, you see a body of a person kind of crumpled over, sitting on the floor, and it's been there for a while. It's obviously been dehydrated and somewhat desiccated over the years, but it's missing a head. I would like for all characters, I'm going to ask the first two, so it's going to be Wilson and it's going to be Davis, to take a stress dice, please. Add one stress, yep.
Now, when we check off the stress on our character sheet, does the dice rollers take that into account?
Yeah, no, it's manual, so you just gotta know how many you gotta add.
Perfect.
Yep.
All right, that would indeed stress Wilson out.
And something about the way he's sitting there just doesn't seem right.
Without touching the headless body, is there any way to, like, is there an identification tag on him, or any kind of uniform, or?
You don't see any type of identification on him, but you do see sitting next to him, appears to be a shotgun, and it's kind of laying there on his side, and where his head should have been against the wall, you can see like scorch marks and what appears to be dried matter into the wall.
So it's very likely that he blew his own head off.
Yes, it looks that way.
That's the first thing they teach us in piloting school.
And what's that?
If you're ever in a hostile situation,
blow your head off.
Blow your head off.
Davis, why don't you you know how to work this thing?
Which
handing
thing?
Handing him the shotgun.
Oh, very good. Yeah, I can handle that.
And then I'll try to enter into the cryo common corridor there. I'm assuming the doors are still working.
The doors are working, and inside the rooms, you can see many of the empty cryo chambers. In cryo chambers 1 and cryo chambers 2, there doesn't appear to be anybody. But you see activity and lights in cryo 3. The door is still closed, though.
All right, I'll go ahead and enter cryo chamber 3 just to see who we have waking up.
Inside cryo 3, let's see. As you walk up to the door, you notice that on the door there are claw marks all the way around. It looks like the door is locked from the inside.
Oh, okay.
You're going to need to do something to try to get in.
Who's got the cutter? Bring the cutter forward here.
All right, here comes Rye.
Okay.
Let's go ahead and see if you can open up cryo chamber 3.
So it's going to be a heavy machinery roll.
Yay! Good man.
I know what I'm doing.
That's going in your report, brother.
And I'm going to need you to make a fuel roll, because you actually used it twice now, and I forgot the first time.
So do I just... Is it the same as an air?
It works the same idea, yep.
Okay.
So you used up one.
So I want to check this shotgun to see if it's got any rounds.
It's loaded, and it seems to have like a full magazine minus one. And in the pocket, in the open zipper pocket, you can see what looks like to be reloads, enough for one full reload.
Ah, very good.
So that shotgun, let's see here. Is a model 37A2. So on that sheet there, you should see a, let's see, model 37.
Yeah, I've got it down already.
Oh,
as
you got
far
it
as the,
okay.
Yeah, but I don't know what the ammo count is.
Well, the way it works in this game is kind of you don't count actual shots. If you get a stress dice, you could be out of ammunition or
gotcha.
Type of thing.
Gotcha.
So
all I have to keep track of is reloads.
Yes, that's correct. So as you were starting to cut open the door successfully... you hear over the PA system the sound of Mother saying, "Warning, cryo chambers deactivated." And you can start seeing now like the lights, the doors on the cryo chambers are opening up, and you can see movement starting to take place inside. What do you guys want to do?
I guess we better help them out if they're starting to wake up.
Yep. Yeah, I agree. Let's go. So I'll go in.
All right. So you go on in, and you can see people starting to move and get up. They're not in a very good condition at all, actually.
Like, but, is it normal space sleep condition? Or
yes, it's the same normal... The same normal conditions that you just woke up in a few minutes ago.
Perfect.
So I'm going to throw some tokens onto the table, and I will introduce them. So we have Johns. We have Reed, who looks obviously like a military type. Yeah, Flynn. You have Cooper. And you have Horton.
Is there any juice boxes or anything around here in these guys?
Probably down in the galley.
And this should store them right here.
Yeah, no, there's nothing there, but there's elevators and there's shafts to take it to the to the galley if you want to go.
Yeah, I guess I'll Rye will help them get to the galley. But don't we have to turn like life support on now, full life support?
Well, the air is still stale, but it seems like stuff is starting to come on.
Oh, it's coming on automatically.
Yeah. It seemed like whenever, as soon as Wilson put the key card in to go into Mother's office there, the mainframe, it seemed like it did something.
So we can assume, even though primary life support's down, there must be some auxiliary that's at least keeping some air and pressure, right?
Yes, that's right. It just seems was put in kind of like a hibernation state, right?
Yeah. And in order to get the primary up and running, we're going to have to get the engines fired up.
Yeah, we could probably cut back through Junction C2 and drop down into the near the reactor and have a look around.
Well, as these people start waking up, like... you know, trying to be encouraging, everybody take it easy. And I know you're disoriented. Just, take it easy.
What happened? Like, where are we? You see one of them, speak up and say this. This is the military looking dude, the Marine, this guy right here. He's like, where are we? What's going on?
Well, son, you're still aboard the Kronos. We just kind of stumbled across you, and we're here to help.
You can see that they're all kind of messed up, and I guess with the long hibernation sleep, they are obviously in, need of some medical care.
We're going to go back to the examination room and see if I can find any sort of anxiety medicine for them, because they will have suffered quite a loss with 25 of their members missing.
And Cooper, this guy right here. He sees you going back, and he's like, can you get me some pills, man? My head's killing me.
Yeah, I'll look around. I'll see what we got back here.
All right, so you're going back to the examination room?
Yeah, I'm going to go back and see if there's any sedatives that might ease any sort of anxiety that they're going to have from missing their crew members. And I'm also... looking for some other pills, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, I do. When you go back to the examination room, you see that the examination room is a complete mess and a complete disarray. You're picking around for the for some stuff, and you do find two personal med kits. And you also find like some sort of like moss or lichen type of material kind of growing in and among the shelves like a vegetation of some sort. It's like something that turned moldy years ago and it kind of just grew into like a little weird plants.
Is it penicillin?
Don't touch nothing.
What deck was, did you guys say the galley was on?
The galley is on deck, let's see.
Looks like B deck.
Yeah.
Alright, well let's, maybe we'll see if we can herd these people down to the galley and get some, get some chow and maybe be able to tell us what's going on here.
So before
Are there any useful pills in the med kit?
To find what you've to for yes, there is. For multiple purposes.
Ah, very good.
So
go ahead. I feel much more relaxed.
I didn't know he was a druggie.
heavily.
Okay, so let's see, Dan, as I go by the player's name here now. You do not have your mask on.
That is correct.
So, you need to make a stamina roll minus two. The reason why it's a minus two is because the air supplies is stale and it's uncomfortable or whatever. But you need to make a stamina roll.
Yeah, I don't know if I can make a stamina roll.
Well, let me have a look. Your stamina is is your strength plus your stamina. Now, if you have stamina zero, it's just your strength.
Okay.
Okay, so your strength, let's see here. Your strength is 2 and your stamina is 0. So it's just 2. And it's minus 2, right? It is. It's minus 2.
Oh, yeah, so it's nothing.
Now, you add your stress dice too, whatever your stress is. All right, so...
Oh!
All right, so... You kind of had a little bit of a panic attack here. You need to roll a d6. So just roll your scripted dice there, the base dice, and add your total number of your current stress. So a 6 plus what?
Oh, plus 4.
Plus 4?
Yeah, my stress level is at 4. Right, because I got 2 stresses on the last stress dice thing, and you add that to your stress level. Is that correct?
Yep. Okay, yeah, so as you're going through the pill cases and you're looking through stuff, you get kind of overcome with the air and the dust that you're shaking up in front of you and you're coughing and all that. Your stress goes up an additional 1.
Ah. Very good.
Hey, Miller, this is Wilson. Copy?
Yeah, go ahead there, Miller.
We found 5 survivors in cryo. Mother on board seems to have already taken the liberty of waking them up, but they're pretty out of it. We're gonna try to get them down to the galley on the B deck to get them help deal with the hypersleep sickness.
Deal with the hypersleep sickness. Yeah, that's a good idea. Are you going to leave them there on the ship? What's the condition of the ship like?
Well, power, you know, things are starting to come back on slowly, it seems, but Mother over here is telling us that we need to get there's been some damage to the ship, and we're going to have to repair the main ship, get the main engines back online and get primary life support systems back on. It's kind of messed up over here. We got one dead body as well so far.
Oh, that's horrible.
Some poor bastard blew his head off.
I wonder why they did that. Did they know anything?
Not yet. They're too out of it right now. We'll update you as soon as we get any information.
All right, no problem. Yeah, that's a good idea. Just go up and try to get some food and see what's on the go.
Copy.
All right, so is everyone going to head up now to the galley on the second floor?
Yeah, I think we need to try to herd these people over there.
All right, I'm going to get you two, Wilson and Cham, to roll their air dice, please, for their suits.
For our suits?
Yes, that's right.
And we roll a stress dice as well for this, right?
No, not for your supplies. Nope.
Not this. Okay.
So you don't blow. You don't use up any air. And what about Rye?
Yay! Oh.
So he loses one, yep.
Plenty of air left. It's all good.
Cham is starting to run low on his air now. He's down the top. All right. So you guys, what about Davis? Are you going up to the galley as well?
Yeah, I'm going to continue rifling the med kit and pocket the pills that are of interest to me. Close up the med kit, rejoin the group, and head up with them and see if anyone needs a sedative.
All right, so I am going to close
that. I will pull out my near empty pill bottle and shake it around and ask if anyone knows what that is. And then I will tell them that's the pillhead mating call.
All right.
So I'm assuming we're coming down the stairwell here.
Yeah, that's correct. So we'll just use you guys for now.
Okay.
And they're following behind you.
Like zombies.
So as you get to the stairway to head up to level 2. Let's see. C2. So that's the ladders there. If you want to go up the ladders or do you want to go up the elevators? It might be a little difficult for them to go up the ladders.
Oh, I think we should do the elevators. We can take small groups.
Where are the elevators?
The elevators are...
Oh, down here on the... Gotcha. Yeah, that's fine. As long as it appears that there's... Oops. Sorry, Davis. as long as it appears that they're functioning. I don't want to get stuck in one of these things.
Well, as you're walking around that particular corner, you find that elevator, the door is open, and it seems to have like been scorched on the inside. It looks like the elevator collapsed on itself. So that one there doesn't look functional.
Which is this just one?
Yeah, that whole
elevator on each end.
Yeah, that whole portion, that whole side there.
Gotcha. So we're gonna have to go to the other one then, I guess.
And when you travel down that direction, you find that the elevator doors in this one, there seems to be looks like gunshots and scarring and pockmarks on the elevator doors.
What the fuck is going on here?
It even looks like blood in some spots. Dried old smeared blood is throughout the whole area.
Captain Miller, there's some signs of gunfire and something's not right here. Looks like there's some kind of a firefight going on down here.
I'm not liking this at all. I want you to... I think you guys should all come back with everybody. Just come back to the ship. I'm getting kind of nervous here of what's going on.
You know what? Maybe that's not such a bad idea. If we at least get the survivors onto our ship, we can feed them in our galley. And figure out what's going on.
That's a good idea. We can maybe do a little interview with them, see how much they know about their journey and what their mission was.
Yeah, let's head back up to Alpha Deck and make our way back to the umbilical.
Okay, yeah, and you hear Miller over the radio. She's like, I'm going to start getting the ship ready here to disconnect the umbilical and stuff, just going through the checks. So just give me...
Well, hang on, Miller. I mean, we still have our mission here to do. We have been told by the corporation, the company, we need to not only rescue these people, but we need to rescue the ship. Let's find out what's going on before we start talking about bugging out.
Well, I'm not saying we'll bug out, but I don't know if we should stay. You know, are those people okay? Are they secure?
They're secure. They're still really out of it from the hypersleep.
Well, we can. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know what to do.
Let's rendezvous and we'll all talk about it.
Okay, no problem. So as you guys are, let me see here. As you guys are starting to head back towards, the docking, the umbilical. You hear over Miller's radio this.
Warning. This is not a drill.
Warning.
Evacuation sequence activated. Warning. This is not a drill.
Something's going on over here. Oh my god.
Miller?
Everyone take one stress level.
Warning. Evacuation sequence activated.
This is coming over her radio. And she's like, the ship is disconnecting on its own. It's I don't know what's happening.
Miller, what are you doing?
I don't know. The ship just kind of kicked in, and it's like it's Oh my god, it's activated the self-destruct sequence.
Miller, get off that ship then.
But the ship, it'll take out the two of the ships.
Yeah, I'm gonna hightail it to the bridge.
You're gonna run there?
Yeah.
Make a
Which bridge? On the Kronos or
on the Kronos. We don't have any engines though, do we?
Nope.
Ah shit. Yeah, scratch that.
Back over the radio it goes again. Mother is refusing to turn off the self-destruct. It's almost like it's doing it on, it's on its own. You can hear Miller getting obviously pretty panicked here right now.
Warning. This is not a drill.
Well, we got two things we can do. We can go troubleshoot the Montero, or we can try to get our reactor up and get out of the way of the blast. I mean, that's about it.
That doesn't sound like an alert sound at all.
Sound like the Bavarian polka team warming up.
Everything's messed up on this ship. That wouldn't surprise me if that's the alert.
Miller goes, if this ship doesn't disconnect, we're going to lose probably both of them.
Miller, is there any way for you to disengage the ship, but get your spacesuit on and evac the plant, the spaceship.
If I don't, I'm gonna make a decision now. What about? Oh God. Okay. No problem. What about the cargo? We'll lose all the cargo. We got roughly 9 minutes left. We'll lose everything.
How long will it take to move the cargo?
We could probably... it would probably take...
What?
You might be able to get one or two tanks into... you have a shuttle ship on board made specifically for carrying like one or two tanks. You might be able to get one or two tanks connected and out in 10 minutes maybe.
That's not encouraging. I guess I'd better run to the reactor and start bringing everything back online. Because I don't want to blow up with the other ship.
Alright, I'm going to get everyone to make another air roll for their suits.
Does the Montero have any sort of... escape shuttles or pods or any other auxiliary craft?
It's got that little ship, the shore shuttle, that's used for towing like individual tanks. It's
like a little small cargo. So ideally, Miller and is Miller the only one on board?
Miller is the only one on board right now. Yeah.
So Miller could actually disconnect and pilot the ship away. Hit a shuttle and come back towards this ship at some point. Maybe.
Yes.
And if that's the case, if the ship does self-destruct, she can't get it, she has no control, the ship is already lost, then she could at least save her own life. If she can get it out of the blast radius of this ship.
Correct, yep.
So I will make that recommendation.
All right, so she's going to try to do that. You guys hold tight. And first of all, I will get everyone to roll their air suits first. Who hasn't?
Roll which?
Your air supply for your suits.
Air supply, gotcha.
Rye's like not sucking back any air whatsoever.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're supposed to roll stress dice, right?
Stress dice, yep.
My bad.
No problem. All good. All right. I need to make a roll here. So let's see. This is brutal.
JC, I have to tell you, you've already got my heart rate going.
So you hear the sudden disconnect of the airlock and the umbilical disconnecting from the ship. You can hear the whole Kronos kind of rocks by the movement, I guess, from the air jettison from the tube, and you hear Miller saying, "Okay, I'm going to try to give it a shot," and she actually manages to get the ship away. And in the background, you keep hearing these warning sounds and beeps and beeps and beeps. And she says, "Okay, I gotta try and run to the shut up, R2. I'm gonna try to get to the shuttle."
We'll meet you up at the same A1 junction.
So.
We might have to meet her at a different junction since that door is damaged.
Oh, that's right. We cut that door, didn't we? Shoot.
Yes. So maybe B2, B1?
Well, this ship does have a vehicle bay.
It has a vehicle bay. That's a nice landing place. Oh, yeah. She can get her shuttle right in there. Psh. Hopefully, if there's room, we'll have to figure out if there's room enough for it. Be nice if she could park the shuttle in there.
So within a few moments, although in space no one can hear you scream and technically you cannot hear explosions, the ship Montero explodes. And let me see. The ship, Kronos, is rocked by debris hitting the hitting the ship, and stuff is rattling and crashing down and rocking out, but everything seems to be okay inside, but no sign of Miller yet.
Miller, do you cop? Miller, did you get off? God damn it.
Suddenly, seeing the people were following you, and they're all kind of dazed and confused, put them all there. Suddenly, Cooper, he collapses. And he starts screaming in pain. And he kind of falls over and his hands are on his head. And he's like, "Oh, my head, it's killing me.
Pain, oh,
so bad."
Isn't med lab around here somewhere?
Yes. Yeah, let's get him to the med lab.
He's obviously unable to... none of the other crew can help because they're still kind of too sick and disoriented right now. Cham runs over, and he gets by the Cooper, and he's like, okay. Oh my goodness, he said, look at it, Cooper. Cooper, this guy, you know, he's got like blood coming down out of his nose, and he's not looking all that good. What do you guys want to do?
Jam, get step back. And Rye, try to get the others away from that dude.
Yeah, give him some air. Give him some air.
There you go.
Why don't you guys go to the mess hall? We'll take care of this.
So as Cham is trying to push them back, okay, where is Rye to right now? Rye up in the forefront, or is he back in the crowd?
Well, he's holding back the people, so he's trying to get them back, so I guess he's in between.
Okay, that's good. Okay, so... apparently, Cooper now completely falls over and into a seizure, and he's convulsing now onto the floor.
Anybody got a med kit?
I got a med kit.
I assume we've got some kind of rapid injection devices. Let's yep. try some of those.
Yep, it's all in the med kit.
All right.
So you can make a... what's it to? Medical aid roll, which is your empathy plus your medical aid. And if you have medical kits, you can add... I can't remember what medical kits add. What do they add? Personal med kits add plus two to the roll.
Okay. I will make that roll. I can roll six for that. I have an empathy of four, and a med kit gives me plus two. Is that correct?
Right. So you roll that plus whatever stress you have.
Stress, yes.
Yeah, that's my man.
Oh my goodness, look at the stress you got. That's crazy. All right, so first of all, now, before you... because you got three successes total, but you need to take a panic check. So roll your dice and add the total number of stress.
Which dice am I rolling?
D6, sorry.
Okay.
Oh, just roll 1d6.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry, you can just ignore
that. I'll re-roll that.
And you rolled a 6. High is bad in this game, just to let you know.
Yeah, 12 altogether.
Okay, so you, in the process of doing this, you are too, as you're trying to put the injector into Cooper's arm, he completely, you hear like the sickening pop come from him, and blood just kind of blows out through his nose and through his ears. You scream. You scream your lungs out for one full round, losing your next point of action. So you're pretty much you're completely stunned. Your stress is actually decreased by one, but every friendly character who hears your scream must make an immediate panic roll.
Oh!
So we'll start with Wilson. So a panic roll.
Damn it, Jim, I'm a pilot, not a doctor.
So Wilson is a 1d6, and you add the number of stress to that roll.
Okay, 1d6.
Yeah, so one base dice.
A base dice, sorry.
Yeah. So you're going to add the total number of stress that you have.
So,
So it's plus one because you just took a stress there then, right? So it's going to be three total.
Okay.
So 4, 5, 6, 7.
Oh, so we took a stress from hearing him and we do a roll.
Yes, that's correct.
Gotcha. Yeah, so 7.
All right, and I am going to get Rye to do a panic roll.
Okay, so I'm a little fuzzy what I have to roll.
Okay, so when you do a panic roll, you just roll a single d6, which is a base dice.
Okay.
And to whatever number that you roll, you add the number of stress to that roll. So if you So if you roll, you got 4, so if you roll like a 2, you're going to have 6 stress of 6. And
so I have 2 because I just took one because I heard the inhuman scream.
Right? Correct. Yep.
So that's 3 stress added on to what I currently have.
Yes, that's correct. Perfect. So you rolled a 1, so that gives you a 4, right?
Should be 5 because I took one for the scream I had one.
Okay. 4. All right. Yeah. Well, you're still good. Yeah, you keep it together.
I'm sorry. I'm not sure what was the result of my roll.
Oh, well, yours right now is a nervous twitch, and you are fine.
I don't add any more stress.
No. Your stress level and the stress of level of all other friendly PCs in the area increased by 1.
Oh, okay.
So, Davis, your stress goes up an additional 1. And it looks like, yeah, Rye got 1, and yeah.
So that's another 1?
That's another stress added. It's not another panic roll.
Okay. Jesus, the stress is just climbing.
I didn't think stress was going to go up as fast as it does, but it's it does, apparently.
Stress is the new doom.
Hey, I don't know. Hey, what are you getting at? What are you trying to say?
Nothing.
Okay, so as Davis is trying to put an injector into Cooper's arm. A sickening pop and a bloody splash as his eyeball launches from the face and bounces into Davis's own forehead. And then the eyeball rolls across the floor. This time you pause, trying to process exactly what it is you're seeing, and you see a slender, gore-covered arm push its way through Cooper's empty eye socket. It reaches around and tugs at his distended mouth as a spindly white finger yanks his teeth back. Cooper does not scream. It's clear that he isn't in his own head anymore. Something else is, and it wants out. Flesh tears and the tendons snap as the thing inside his splittering its skull it pulls a face open right out at the jawline.
Jam, burn it!
Finally, a thick, gurgling sound wells up inside Cooper as his head is ripped from his body, his neck gushing as whatever was inside him plops down into the floor in a burst of blood. Kill it now! Kill it now! Which Wilson is already yelling out. The translucent white thing on the floor sloughs off his placenta, struggling to stand on all 4 wobbly, fawn-like legs. shaking brain matter from its spiky hide. The bloodburster turns its bulbous, eyeless head towards you and crouches.
I think I'm going to lose my shreddies.
So, right now, this takes us into a combat event. And so I just got to get up the right stats here.
Maybe it's friendly.
It just needs a hug.
It just needs a face to hug.
And of course my tablet is acting up here. So the way this game works is that everyone draws a card, and it starts from the lowest number to the highest number in the way that you act. And every character can make either one fast action and one slow action, or two fast actions per turn.
Okay.
All right. Now this little thing... where's my cards? Okay, I gotta get them out of objects. Components. So I am going to, just for the sake of this event, I'm going to change out the... Let's see. We'll zoom in here. And... So we got Cooper in the back, Wilson is there. We have the Rye is back in the back. Davis is up there. Everyone is kind of back here. So the way I'm going to work this out is each... I'll draw it. So this, for example, here, I'm drawing a line around it, is a zone. Okay, everyone see that?
Yep.
So each room is going to be considered a zone for this purpose.
Okay.
All right. So if you're in a zone, you're in the zone with someone else. But if you're next to him, you're considered engaged.
Okay.
Okay. So the way this works is I am going to deal a card to everyone. So I will deal a card to red, deal a card to white, deal a card to green, and I actually get two cards. I gotta bring those back. I never shuffled them. I forgot to shuffle. Group, shuffle, there we go, so deal to red, deal to green, deal to white. So you start from the lowest number, I'm going to get rid of that pulse rifle, because it's in the way.
It's the alien that's killing me.
So the way this works is that you start with the lowest number, and you work its way up. Because the alien has a speed of 2, it allows me to draw 2 cards. So technically I'll have double the amount of actions. But I can only act on turn 3 and turn 8. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yep.
All right. So just to make things a little easier, on the cards themselves, to help keep you keep you thinking, I got free action and slow action. So whichever way works best for you, if you turn your card so you can read it, that means that you've done, like, say, a fast action. If you use your slow action, you can turn it so your slow action is up so you can read it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just a way of helping people keep track of what they're doing. So I need to get, like, a little a creature here. So I'm going to search. We're going to use a face hugger icon because that's all I got.
Hey, Jolly.
Yeah.
Could you move this alien on the table? It's like in my green zone. My card is not, like, when you deal it to me, it's like under this alien.
There you go.
Yeah, thank you.
No problem.
Thank you, sir.
All right, so it looks like the first turn gets to go to Wilson. So on that sheet, on the chart below your character sheet, over on the far right-hand corner, you got your slow actions and your fast actions.
And I can do one of each, or I can do 2 fast actions.
Correct. And because this thing kind of popped out at your feet, I'm going to consider you all engaged. You two engaged.
All engaged.
Except for Rye.
Now, why aren't I engaged? Is that because it's, like, attacking me already?
Well, no, you're not engaged because you're saying that you're keeping the people back away from the group.
Oh, okay.
So this thing kind of gave birth and landed right at the other two guys' feet. You're back away from it. So you're in the same zone, but you're not engaged with the creature itself.
Right, okay.
Okay, so engaged, I'd be up next to him then?
Yep. Cooper's dead, so we'll get rid of Cooper.
Bye, Cooper.
So I'm going to use my fast action to retreat, which is a mobility check.
Yep. Don't forget to roll to add your stress dice, which I love.
Yes. My stress is nice and high right now. Let's see. Mobility for me is... Where's mobility? There it is. Okay. So I have a 2 mobility, a 4 agility, but because of the suit, I take -1.
Correct.
So that would be 5. Plus 4 stress dice.
Yep. So now you roll your stress. So you got 1 success so far, and you got no stresses, so you're good. So you actually successfully disengaged from the creature.
I'm a corporate puke guy. Sorry, I'm not a colonial marine.
You don't have to use all your actions,
right?
Because if you get attacked, if you want to try to block it, you need to have a fast action to do something like that.
Oh, gotcha.
Right? So you don't, you kind
of... So you don't have to use all of your stuff all at once.
No,
gotcha.
That's correct.
Yeah, I think I'm just going to... I'll be ready to block if I have to.
All right, so you've disengaged... But you're not going to do anything else.
Nope, I'm gonna
right.
Well, I guess, do I need to draw my weapon? I'm assuming I didn't have it in my hands.
No, that's correct.
So, I'm going to... This round, I'm actually going to go ahead and draw my weapon. So, I'll use my second fast action.
No problem. So, you got your actions done.
Yes.
All right. So, the next is me. I'm going to take a fast action. It seems like the closest person now would be to... It's going to attack Davis.
No, not Davis!
So I need to roll... This is where it gets a little different. I need to roll the dice and see what it's going to do. So I rolled a 6.
Davis, if you die, can I have your shares?
This white little creature, this monster that just kind of crawled out of the throat of Cooper, seems to want to go for yours. And it lunges at you, trying to take a bite out of your neck. Okay, so I have to roll 8 dice. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And this is a... And I got 3 successes. So, do you want to try and block this?
Well, I don't think I have... well... Yeah, I guess. What else can I do?
Well, if you are attacked in close combat, you can choose to block the attack to avoid being hit. Blocking is a fast action. You can roll your close combat skill. Oh, okay. So you got to choose beforehand. So technically, you have to roll your dice and you say you're going to try and block. You roll successes. And if you have any successes, they take away from the attack. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't have any close combat skill, though.
That's fine. You just would roll your strength, I think, is what it's attached to.
Okay.
Yeah, as your strength.
So, yeah, okay.
You roll 2?
Yep.
Okay, and roll your stress dice now. And you take 2 stress. Or you go, gotta take a panic roll. So, you didn't block anything, and now you gotta go into a stress attack here. So, what did you roll there? I missed it.
3 and 8. 11.
11. Alright, so, on your next action, you're actually fleeing right now. On your next action, to move, you must move away from danger. All right?
All right.
Essentially, that's what it is. Your stress level is going to be decreased by 1. But everyone in the same zone as you has theirs increased by 1. So yours is decreased. Everyone else goes up by 1.
I love that.
It's crazy, eh? How it adds to everything.
Hey, what happens when you run out of checkboxes for stress?
That's the 10 is the maximum you can get.
Oh, so it's not like Cthulhu where we go insane or something like that.
No, not that I think. No. I think 10 is just the highest it goes.
Perfect.
And how do you reset it? I know that you have to probably have a shift or something like that.
Yeah, you got to try and rest and hey, I just got a new follower on Twitch. That's the first time I've ever got one live. Thanks, Dave, for following me. Appreciate it. yeah, so the way you get rid of stress is that you reduce the... You can try to nap. You can take a break. You can hold on to your personal item. Everyone has a personal item. And that helps reduce stress by one.
Oh, I wish I would have known that when I was shaking my empty pill bottle earlier.
All right, so you've used up a fast action to block. All right, so just to keep that in mind, Davis. So now this thing continues on its attack because it didn't. You didn't block it at all. All right, so this thing goes for your throat. I'm going to do 3 points of damage to you, total. I'm going to use up my 3 successes, and I'm going to do 3 points of damage. Now, you have armor on your character.
Yes.
You roll that amount of dice. For every 6 that you roll, it reduces the damage by 1.
So it's just the armor?
Just the armor, yep. So use your base dice for that one. You rolled a 6, and that was it, was it?
Yep. And all right, I roll so stress?
You take 2 points of damage. Now, here is the big thing. Now, how many hit points did you have in the first place?
I got 2.
Oh, so you're broken anyway. You are broken. All right, so as this thing lunges towards you, it forces, it grabs onto you. Its teeth actually sink through the material that's on your suit, and I guess where you had your helmet off, it managed to get into your throat, because if it had the glass on your face, it probably wouldn't have done as much damage. So this thing hits you, bites you in the throat, and it causes critical injury 61. And that critical injury...
They told us about that in pilot school.
shake it off.
They said, whatever you do, don't get critical energy to 61.
I gotta find the chart. I have trouble finding the chart. Well, here we go. 61. This is a fatal wound that you received. Your jugular has been ripped open.
Ooh.
Your stamina, any stamina roll that you have. Okay, so you reach up and you grab your neck. This thing is, you know, hold on to it, takes a big chunk out of your neck. It is a fatal roll. Your character will die in one round if no one does a medical first aid on you, which is going to be a -1.
Doesn't Davis have the med kits?
Davis does have the med kits.
That's very convenient.
So that was... Where is this to? Anyway, yeah, so Davis, you're wounded heavily right now, and you're dying. So that was my slow action. That's what I took. It is not going to take its other action. So who gets to go next? Who's number 4? Or 5? Davis.
Yes.
You cannot do anything right now.
I feel incapacitated.
You are broken, yes. So you are immediately broken. You are not dead. You can crawl and mumble through pain. You can't perform any other actions. You can't roll for any skills. Any further damage against you does a critical injury.
Ooh. Brutal.
Okay. So
I will attempt to mumble. Provided I don't have to roll any stress.
No, you're good that way. You won't have to worry about stress much longer. Yeah. So that was action number 5.
You can have my stock, but you can't have my pills.
That was turn number 5. Anyone out there a 6? No.
Did you give a card to Cham?
I did, yep.
Okay.
Oh, no, I didn't. Hold on. He's a 7. Oh, Cham is. What would Cham do in this situation?
Well, Wilson's suggesting burn it! Burn it!
And he's got the incinerator.
He does.
But are you saying for him to go ahead and flame everyone who's standing all? Because the thing is technically on Davis's neck right now.
Wilson is screaming, "Burn it, burn it!" He's panicked. What can I say?
Cham is a rough. He's loyal, and so he is going to. He is going to move up. He's going to take a short action to move up, and he's going to engage the creature. And he is going to attack. And he has a close combat skill of 2. His strength is 5, so he rolls 7 dice.
Nice. Cham.
And I get a hit. Does the Neomorph have... armor? The Bloodburster. This thing is called a Bloodburster. Holy smokes, and I got 3 dice of 3 dice of armor. And Cham comes up and he punches at it, and it doesn't do any damage to it. So now the creature is going to... Let's see what the creature is going to do. He rolled a 1. With a snarl, the Bloodburster flees, moving 2 zones away in a single action into the nearest air duct, if possible. So this creature jumps off of Davis and actually disappears out of sight.
Oh, the little bastard.
And it is gone. And now it's Rye's turn.
Jesus, what the hell just happened?
I didn't realize how deadly this game. I knew it was deadly, but I didn't realize how
deadly. This puts Cthulhu to shame. I'm going to run to Davis and try and like put pressure on the wound to keep him from bleeding. All right. Or something like that.
Yep.
Whatever I think is necessary as they get there.
So it's going to be a medical roll, medical aid roll, and it's a minus one. Because of the style of wound that it is.
Okay, so that makes it four. My empathy plus my medical aid is five, minus one is four. And then I have to roll my stress dice too.
You add your stress to it, yep.
Oh, to the
number of dice that you roll. So you have a stress of what right now?
Six, seven.
All right, so you're going to roll your base dice plus seven stress dice.
Okay.
So you got two successes. Now, if you don't freak out and panic, you might be able to save them.
Okay, here comes the stressors. I'd like to apologize in advance.
I mumble.
That might be your last mumble. Just hang on.
You don't want to roll ones. Ones are bad. Oh, you did it!
Nice!
Nice.
So you got a total of five successes total, all right? Minus one, so you got four. So what do you do with those four extra successes?
Three of the successes I used to take Davis's shares, and the other success I used to stay... and if I can't do that, then I'll just put it towards reviving David. And maybe he won't have as big a scar.
Alright, so let's see here. So there's no extra bonuses. If a person who... Okay. Save a life. The most critical use for medical aid is saving a person's life of a fallen character who has suffered a critical injury. A frail roll at this point could mean the end of your patient, so be careful. Okay, yeah. So there's no extra benefits for rolling that. But you do manage to save Davis's life.
All right.
He owes me now, and I'll make sure he knows it.
Ryan, I'm going to make sure I put that in your report.
But he's still broken right now, so if you do another medical aid roll, you can actually get him not broken anymore.
What if I fail that? Does that mean it, like, kills him?
No, it just means that he doesn't recover.
Okay, so roll the exact same things again?
Yes.
And am I still at minus one?
Now, you don't have to do that right now. You can wait and perhaps get him into the med lab. You might be able to help him out that way. Or you can... you can try it now with stress. You know, you can try to take a break, or you can try... Wait till after. Because he's fine now. He's stable. He's broken. He just can't do anything.
Okay.
For now.
Yeah, let's wait. The adrenaline is too much right now. I can't think to do any more to say he's good. He's stabilized. One thing at a time.
So. So 1 second, I'm just having trouble finding. Okay, so first aid can get you back up, or you can get up on your own. If you're broken and no one is around to help you, you automatically recover 1 point of health after one turn, as 5 to 10 minutes has passed. Now, before we go any further, I'm going to get everyone to roll their oxygen dice again, because you two guys are still in your suits.
Yes, I am.
And this sounds like a pretty stressful moment for oxygen.
And do we roll stress dice with oxygen?
No, you just roll your stress dice total. So whatever is remaining of your air is what you roll your stress. So you would roll 4.
Thank you.
So your stress, your air goes down by 1. And Wilson's goes down by 1.
You got that already?
And yeah. I really like the mechanic of how those things track down, you know? Meanwhile, everyone is in kind of panic mode right now. So, you guys are heading to the med lab right now?
Yeah, I think that's the best for for Davis's condition, and maybe the rest of ours.
Okay, so let me find it. So you, let me bring back the med lab again. Bring back the main map. So where is the med lab? Oh, back here. All right, so we'll just move one character there for now. So we'll keep track of it. So who's carrying Davis?
I'll take one shoulder if someone else can help on another.
Yeah, I'll take the other shoulder.
All right, so Cham, you guys are kind of going on there carrying him. You come to this, you walk into the room, and right off the get-go, you see two of the older-style med pots used for, you know, they got like a plexiglass tube, they got all the instruments inside. But right off the get-go, you notice that one of them is broken, and there's shattered glass on the floor. The other one seems to be sealed, and it's lit from within. But the entire inner surface of the plexiglass is covered in... looks like dried blood.
Oh no.
There is a row of large specimen jars sitting on the table. Floating within the two of them are two smaller alien creatures, one that which looked just like what just jumped out of Cooper a minute ago.
Does it look to be alive? I'll actually tap the glass to see if it's alive.
There is, okay. They don't seem to be moving.
Okay.
I'm just having a look here.
Is there some place, like at least an examining table or something we can put Davis on?
Yeah, there's an examining table there. There's a table there that has a bunch of vials on it, as I said.
Do we still have a med pack, or are they all gone?
There's still one left. Because there's still one on, because Davis had 2.
Okay, now, I'll go ahead and use the second one then and try to treat Davis.
Now, there is, on this, to let you know, just as you walked in there, although one of the pods looked like it's got, you know, blood and everything in it, it does appear to be working.
Yeah, I'm not certain we want to necessarily open that. I'm going to ask Cham, keep an eye on that.
All right, Chan goes over and kind of like, okay, yeah, no problem.
And I'm just going to go ahead and try to treat Davis.
All right, so it is a medical aid roll plus your stress.
Medical aid. So that would be 6 dice plus 5 stress.
So you got 2 successes there. Now your stress dice. All right. Mm-hmm. So it looks like Davis is back to full health. You managed to staunch the bleeding.
Just a flesh wound.
And you actually tapered him up. It probably wasn't as bad as you thought it was at first. I guess he's more of a panic roll. Maybe he might be a cool pilot under pressure, but when it comes to getting a small scratch, not so much. But it looks like Davis has 2 hit points back to his maximum again.
Nice.
Well done.
Very good. Thank you.
So, guys, we are pretty much looks like to be right on track for act ending act 1.
Excellent.
How do you guys feel about calling it now? Because we've been at this now for 4 hours.
Have we really?
Yes.
Yes.
It does not feel like it. I'm loving it.
Yeah, I really did enjoy this game. It doesn't feel like 4 hours.
Because we can certainly attempt this again, maybe next week.
Yeah, whenever you guys are free.
Now, Kelly seems to be a little quiet there.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm good. I don't know when my availability will be, but you guys definitely carry on without me if I can't make it, for sure.
All right, no problem.
Usually I work early Monday morning. It's just with the holiday.
My comms have been going in and out in the past couple of minutes, so I'm not hearing everything, guys.
All right, sorry about that. Yeah, okay, but yeah, because I don't want to start the next act and know that we probably only get another hour or two into it. You know what I mean?
For sure. Yeah, Yeah, I agree with everyone. It's gone quick.
Yeah.
It don't feel like 4 hours.
It doesn't. I was actually shocked when I looked at it. When I just looked at it. Because usually right now playing Conan, I'm about to go into some sort of convulsion or something. But
No, but I meant what I said earlier. And this, just the build-up, really, I could tell it had my heart going.
That was good. I'm very glad that you liked it. I was looking for...
Very, very enjoyable.
I was looking for something to play here, and I couldn't find it. Sorry. Where is it? Oh, there it is.
That was Davis's throat. There we go.
There it is. I was looking for it the whole game, and I couldn't find it. There it is. Anyway, yeah, I got all the alien sounds too. That'll work into this over time.
That is awesome. Anyway, love the motion tracker.
I really enjoyed it. It's a little different. Like, it's so simplistic, but it adds a lot to role playing, I think. But
yeah. Oh, it does, and I mean, it's, you know, simplistic is you know, it's not bad. You know, the nice thing is that it's, don't get me wrong, I love the Conan system, but there's a lot of metagaming going on.
Yes.
Here, that's, because the system's so simple and it's so deadly, there's really no metagaming. It's just, it is what it is.
Yeah, I like that too. The mechanics don't get in the way of the investigation.
Exactly.
Yeah. No, it's. I'm really happy with it. I'm looking forward to this one. Yeah. So this is only like my 3rd or 4th game now using Tabletop Simulator 2. So I'm still getting into the basics of how to use it in a game, but I think it works fairly smooth.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, this was Kelly's first shot, first time ever using tabletop. How do you feel about it? And be honest, too. I'm cool.
Well, it took I don't know if I'm still 100% with the moving around and which button to press to go where. Because I'm used to Fantasy Grounds where it's fairly two-dimensional, right?
That's right, yep.
So, but otherwise, I think I'm getting the hang of it, and it's, I like, it's certainly a different type of immersion into the game.
It is, yep.
Yep.
I think, like, for Alien, it's fairly rules light. I don't know how well, like a D&D game would work with it. Hmm. If it's like all those fiddly bits and moving around and everything, I don't know what that would be.
Yeah, true, because there you're moving everything, like, here is pretty abstract.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. And I think it works really good.
Because the only games I've used this with now is with Conan and with Coriolis and this one. And everything is zone-based, you know?
Okay.
Well, Coriolis isn't. Coriolis is based on, like, inches. So.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, so this... yeah. Anyway, over time, I use the process and try to smooth things out a little bit more. But yeah, no, this is the game. I've been waiting to play this game, and I'm very happy with the system, with the feel of it.
Yeah, I like Alien so far. It's. I mean, it's easy for me to say that. I'm not the one who nearly died.
No, I like it too. I got the character that I got was a reckless character, and I was able to play it reckless. And there's a lot of times when you get a character that has a trait, and it's hard to play because the mechanics won't let you play. You're out of this one. It's like you said, it's so simplistic. It's easy to play to the character, and I like that a lot.
Yep, no, that's cool. That is cool. All right, guys. Well, I'm going to save this game. Hopefully in the future we can continue onwards with this.
Sounds great. I'll be looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'd like to see what happens in Act 2 and 3. See how the tension ramps.
Because, Kelly, I know, because you got the book, right? You went and got the pre-order like I did, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So I know that you're kind of... I'm pretty sure that you probably looked at the whole adventure so far.
No, actually, I didn't read the... I think I read a bit of the intro, but we're past where I ever read.
Oh, really? Okay, good. I was a little worried because I was thinking about having to modify a few things so you can have a little bit of a surprise too as well. So,
No, if I did read it, I don't remember it. But I don't... Like, none of this is familiar.
Cool. Well, you got to the med lab, you exposed a blood burster, and you still got no history of what happened so far.
None yet. We're gonna have to interrogate these individuals.
And what I did like the way the adventure is written out in this game is it gives you a bunch of events that gotta happen, and it gives you a bunch of optional events that don't have to happen, and you get to play these events however you want to do it.
Interesting.
So there's no story to. It's not like previous other adventures that you have written. It just gives you a bunch of things that are going to happen. So whatever happens in between these different things is entirely up to the players.
Huh. That's cool.
And if the players are going to do something, I can take an event that's optional and throw it into that particular whatever you're doing.
Interesting.
You know what I mean?
I got a question about the symbols on the maps.
Okay, yep.
Is there some kind of a legend for these? Or?
Yep, it's down here on the...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, thanks.
And before everyone goes, up at the head of the table, you should see this thing. Can I get you guys to click on it? Like where
click on which
player up here? Yeah, you're on it there, Kelly. Just click on 1 and 2 and 3 or whatever, because it's supposed to way of tracking people's hitboxes. Yeah, Dan, just click on it. Oh, there you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you guys see that as well?
Yeah. I see it. How did you turn that on?
On the top of the table, you click on a number, right? So I'm not sure. So if you click on 1. It takes over whoever's previously touched it.
So on this one, they have two rows of boxes. There's an arrow with a horizontal line on it, and that controls the number of hit points that you have, and then the lower column controls how many you've exhausted.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's so cool.
So where I only have 2 health, I can move that to 2, and then with the other one, I can indicate how many of the 2 that I actually possess.
And that's showing up on your screens too, right?
That is correct.
I like it. All right. And what does that broadcast thing do? It doesn't say. Broadcast is disabled. Huh. So that's a pretty nifty tool there.
Yeah, I like that tool.
Well, guys, I'm going to. The guys are making some people have been laughing at a couple of things. Anyway, I'm going to shut this stream down. We got Boffrin here watching, so thanks for watching, Boffrin. Appreciate it. I'm going to shut this down. And boys, I really appreciate you joining me on this test run of this. Very much.
Yeah, really good.
Yeah, excellent job, as always.
Yeah, thanks for the invite.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It was great meeting the others.
Yeah, it's good meeting you.
We'll I'll send you emails in the future, and maybe we can get to Act 2.
I'd like that.